Joining us now here on set in the CNBC exclusive interview is the CEO of GE, John Flannery. Nice to have you here.
Hey, good morning, David. How are you?
Big day for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
You've been, you know, you and I sat down, it was October of last year.
Yeah.
This process has been a long time in coming. Why, with the day here and this announcement, was it healthcare that you've decided should be separated from this business?
So I'd go up one level in maybe a broader perspective. It's really not just an announcement about healthcare. That's part of the tactical, but it's a broader strategic orientation around the company. We go all the way back to day one. I came into the job with a lot of thoughts about the company from my time in the company, how we run it, how we centralize or decentralize authority, how we allocate capital. Running the healthcare business, I had perspective. So I came into the job with some of these thoughts, that the structure of the company, the portfolio, could be changed and improved in a different setting. So I spent the last year going in a very methodical way to make sure we understood the broad picture of the company. So when you step back today, I'd say it's not just a healthcare story. It's broader repositioning of the core GE. It's a very strong business going forward, aviation, power, renewables. And we thought, as we looked at this process, which businesses would thrive inside the company or outside the company. And we came to the conclusion for healthcare, for transportation, for BHGE, there were unique characteristics of those businesses, investor appetite, et cetera, growth opportunities. They were better off outside of the company. So the core orientation was businesses flourish. How do we create shareholder value?
Okay, and why is then, give me a little bit more sense as to when you look at specific to healthcare,
sure. Yeah.
Why you believe it will flourish outside of GE, yeah, as opposed to inside?
Listen, it was doing quite well inside healthcare.
Yeah, you ran it for a period of time.
Yeah, yeah, I didn't mean it that way.
And it's putting up strong
numbers. It's growing nicely. Yeah. There's just a lot of change in that industry. If you look at, in our imaging business, artificial intelligence, machine learning, rapidly transforming that business. If you look in our bioprocessing business, we see a chance to keep growing that and consolidate that business. There's a lot of things in cell therapy, immunotherapy. There were just a constant stream of investment ideas that I thought we could pursue better in that fashion. And Kieran's laid out a great strategy around precision health, and I really am looking forward to getting my healthcare shares.
Now, 20% going to be monetized, 80% either split or spun in some fashion.
Yeah.
What are we talking about here? When can we expect to actually see this company publicly
traded? So it's 12 to 18 months. We're going to go through all the alternatives. 20-80 is sort of a marker for us right now. If there's a more optimal way to do that, we'll refine that over time. But that's part of, again, a broader package. Second thing I think important for everybody, getting the balance sheet of the company to the right place. So if you take these things together, transferring debt to healthcare, monetizing healthcare,
right,
dispositions.
$18 billion goes to healthcare, but, and pension and in debt as well.
The strong balance sheet, that's how we grow the company.
All right, so tell me what it looks like from your perspective. What represents a strong balance sheet for GE? Because you're certainly not there now.
Yeah, so I'd say at each level, if you look at these companies going forward, healthcare will be well capitalized, Baker's well capitalized, and these actions taken together will drop our leverage at the core GE company below 2.5 times debt to EBITDA. That's strong and within peer line, so they're going to have the firepower and investment power they need to keep growing that business. And that was really, at the end of the day, the objective: position them to grow and focus on getting the shareholder value out of that.
So, and decrease the reliance on things like CP and
the whole balance sheet structure is going to be much lower debt, much higher cash balance, less short-term funding. So I like the portfolio moves. They allow us to do the deleveraging. And then I think when you add on running the company in a really different way, you're going to get a very positive, multiplicative combination here. And I'm a big shareholder, and my compensation's tied to how the stock performs. So
understood.
I'm a believer.
And I know you are. But, there were a number of believers who then were scared a great deal by the liabilities you recognized,
yeah,
on the long-term care,
yeah,
in particular, but others as well. And, what was it? The statutory capital contribution of $3 billion in the first quarter of 18, $2 billion annually.
Yes.
I mean, it adds up to a huge,
yeah,
number. And,
yeah,
they come back and they say, well, how can we be assured that Flannery,
yeah,
knows,
yeah,
everything that's buried there, that there will not be any more surprises?
Yeah.
Can you give that commitment?
So, listen, we've covered the company from corner to corner in terms of analyzing all aspects of the company, insurance, capital, power business. So I'm very comfortable we've got a handle on what's going on inside the company. And I'm very comfortable that when we have seen issues along the way, we've surfaced them, we've dealt with them. And I think today, is another example of that. So the track record of dealing with issues and is
so
there.
So how are you going to hammer down on some of this stuff at GE Capital? Because that's sort of the language that people have used, that we can, over time, we can eliminate.
We want to keep grinding this down.
Yes.
So I think if you think of GE Capital, think of three basic components. One is energy and industrial finance assets. We're sharply reducing those. Then you're left with insurance and GECAS, our aviation leasing business. The insurance business, we're attacking every way possible to get that liability down. And, you know, there's operational things, there's negotiations with our primary insurers, there's transactional things. We're looking at everything. We're highly motivated to do that. If there's something sensible there, we would absolutely be motivated to pursue that.
Somebody really wants to take these policies on?
Well, yeah, sure. There's a market for everything.
I mean,
everything.
I guess at some price,
there's a market
for
everything. And the other thing I'd say, David, important from today is we went through a collection of sources that we have, about $60 billion plus of sources. $25 billion of that's earmarked for deleveraging the company. The rest is there to continue to de-risk and deleverage. So I think we have the firepower to work the insurance issue down, and with the intent for sure. And then with respect to GECAS, that is a real premium asset, a very strong performer in the industry. There's a lot of value in that, a lot of optionality. We get calls on that thing every day. So I think we can clear up the picture in GE Capital. We have the resources to do that, and it's not going to be a drag on the rest of the company.
When I think about what is left of GE, you know, there had been a lot of speculation coming to this day. Perhaps some had thought that aviation, given what a jewel it is and how much highly more it might be highly valued outside the company, might be a part of this.
Yeah.
Are you done? Is this it? Is this
we're
GE
finished.
That I'm going to, you and I are going to be sitting here talking about 2 years from now?
Yes, it is. Absolutely. And, you know, I think as we looked at that, again, part of the analysis was inside, outside. And part of it is these businesses have a lot of commonality that the other two businesses didn't. So heavy sharing of technology. If you look at engine technology, jet engine comes from a gas turbine. You know, ceramics and materials we've used across renewables. And so there's good technology sharing. There's common, very common business model, deep technology, installed base, long-term service annuity. And they're deeply global, you know, infrastructure businesses. So I like that combination of businesses, especially with the right capital structure so they continue to invest. So I step back again and say, as an investor, you get that business directly, well capitalized. You get these other pieces directly with, I think, great prospects. And I'm excited to get to it.
Are we going to see job losses as a result of these announcements?
So there's a philosophy change here that I think is important, is reducing the size of our corporate center and really empowering the businesses to be the center of gravity. And that's a major change in the way we've run the company. And I'm a deep believer in the power of unleashing the businesses and raising their accountability. So
they'll determine the layoffs a particular.
Yeah, I'd say, you know, we are transferring certain things back to the business, eliminating certain things outright. And net-net, at the end of the day, the center of the company will be a fraction of what it is now. Some of it will be in other pieces. Some will be eliminated.
Is that part of the $500 million in additional cost
yes,
savings
that
you identified?
Yes, that's exactly where that is. And I think, you know, I would expect that number to continue to firm up and go
up.
So
you don't need all that real estate you bought in Boston? What about that?
No, we have no changes to our real estate in Boston. That's always been a mixed-use facility of, you know, part headquarters people and part of our businesses. So we have no change on the real estate. But I do want to come back. The philosophy of decentralizing the company, this is a major thought change, and I'm very bullish on it. It doesn't get so much, you know, airtime, I think, is the portfolio things, but it's a very central change in the company, and it's really about emancipating, faster speed, better capital allocation, more focus.
This is GE, the greatest conglomerate of all time. You're going in completely the different
direction. I wouldn't say completely.
No,
I would say moderated. Things, you know, I think companies evolve, markets evolve, and I've seen the company from so many perspectives. The business development strategy, running businesses, being out in the perimeter. So this is an amalgamation of a lot of experience I've had for 10 years. It's not a reaction to, well, we had some issues in the last 12 months.
For those who always thought of aviation as the crown jewel and were maybe hoping that would be the one to be spun, were there arguments for that and why were they not enough?
So at the end of the day, it's a great business. And I come back to the commonality we see in those, the portfolio that we're keeping going forward. So we looked, as we said to everybody at the outset, we are open to everything. I have no preconceptions. I have no ties to the past. I've examined every possible combination you can imagine with this, and we came and the board came to a unanimous conclusion that this was clearly the best path for the company and for the value creation of the company. It's still a great business. And we're also quite confident, you know, renewables is a high growth business, high growth industry. We're making a lot of progress there on our wind business. That's going to quintuple as a percent of energy in the next couple of decades. And then the power business, we said this morning on the call, it's going through a turnaround right now. It's choppy right now. But the business in the industry is not going away. The power generation from gas production is going to be higher 20 or 30 years from now. So we've got the largest
business
there. How
long does it take to turn around power? I mean, I'm looking at remarks you made back on the 24th of May when you were speaking specifically of it. This is not a six-month or even a year turnaround.
It's a long-cycle business in a very challenging short-term, you know, new unit business. I think it's choppy for a year or two, but I have a lot of confidence in the team. They have an extremely specific plan about right-sizing the cost structure, the manufacturing footprint, getting our service business. The core economics of this thing is a huge installed base, 7,000 gas turbines. So we're going to harvest the value of the service stream, get the new unit volume adjusted for our manufacturing footprint. And then the big part of our issue was execution. We had project overruns and, you know, things that we can control. So it's a self-help story. We're not counting on the market getting
better. And
you
replaced a lot of the people. I mean, I can remember our previous interviews where you alluded to that already going on. Has that taken place?
It has. So I think if you look at the company,
you've got the personnel in place that you want to run these businesses.
Yeah, absolutely. So we made heavy changes at the company level, at the power level, and you get a lot of benefit from fresh eyes.
And just to reiterate one of David's questions, I mean, some of the investment world looks at power and aviation as two separate businesses. When you deal with all the problems at GE Credit and the insurance issues, could you anticipate looking at a potential separation of those two businesses?
No, that is our core company going forward. As I said before, we have the intent and the resources to manage GE Capital so that our core industrial businesses can grow and have investment capital. That's a big part of our whole strategy, was to get the financial standing of the company in the right place. So we'll manage GE Capital and let the other ones run hard.
You mentioned capital. I didn't ask you about the $3 billion contribution to GE Capital.
Yeah.
Why is that needed?
Yeah. So that's just, again, recapitalizing the balance sheet. We've got some issues that Jamie mentioned in the call today in terms of asset sales, some things with WMC. But it fundamentally allows us to capitalize the company at the right level going forward. So there's some, you know, regulatory rating agency capital requirements. But the core issue, I think, and message for everyone on GE Capital is we want to materially reduce that business. We want to work our way down through the insurance business, and we have a very valuable asset in GECAS. And so that's our focus.
And pension liabilities are circled efficiently? You don't feel that there's going to be anything again
there?
So
we've looked at that holistically. I've spent a lot, you know, I treat that liability as the same as any other liability. It's something we have to satisfy. It's something we have to fund. We're moving some of the pension with the healthcare business. So I think you're going to see over the next 2 years the unfunded pension liability coming down pretty dramatically.
Wanted to ask you about trade, John. How much is this current spat with our trading partners and China?
Yeah.
How much are you feeling it?
So I'd say in the short-term micro sense, not much. I think financially, as we look at some of the proposals and what they might do, it's not a huge financial impact to us. That said, we're a global company. We're set up for global trade. China's an important market for us in both directions. And so we're concerned about where it could go. We're watching that carefully. Our voice is loud and clear in governments around the world about our position on that. And my expectation is that over time, people do things in their own long-term self-interest, and that things will settle down. But there's a lot of noise right now.
Is there any evidence at GE so far of deferred investment decisions, friction on supply chains, portfolio production?
No, I think everybody's obviously still processing, watching, but I certainly in the short run, we haven't seen any impact that would rise to my level.
You're miles away from shifting production because of all of this.
Yes.
At this point.
Yeah. I think, you know, it's a natural process to look at your supply chains and start to imagine what you might do, but we're not in that mode at all right now.
But this can't be good, though. I mean, you know, it's not the greatest environment to be worrying about, and if obviously things worse.
Listen, it depends where it goes.
Yeah.
You know, so as I said before.
What do you expect? What are your expectations
in terms of
where it goes?
I expect it to be noisy and ultimately settle at a level that makes sense for everybody. How noisy, how long, you know, we have to see. But I think if you look back over time, these things flare up, they go back and forth, and eventually people do what's in their broad self-interest, and I think trade, open trade, it's pretty clear
so
that's been in
there. Do you support what the president is doing here, acting tough on some of our trading partners to lower their tariffs and make it more fair?
These are all negotiations. So I think, you know, any of these topics are ripe for a discussion of what's fair and who's, so I think why not have that discussion? Where it settles out, we'll see.
Back to the announcements of today. Baker Hughes, 2.5 years to 3 years, sounds like an awfully long time to sell down. It's a large stake, but I mean, you can get more liquidity than that. Can't you do it more quickly?
First, we're not talking about selling down the stock, so I want to be clear on that. We're talking about separating the company over 2 to 3 years. How we do that, we have a range of alternatives.
Same way with healthcare. Baker Hughes.
Yeah.
Explain to me then, so the way it's going to be separate. You own, what, 62%?
We own 62.5% of a public company.
Right.
We have not detailed exactly how we will transfer out of that ownership position. We have a range of options.
I see.
You've laid out some. We could spin, we could split. So there's a range of options. Just important on Baker Hughes, I'd say, and healthcare too. These are good, good businesses. So we like them. We just think they're in a better position outside of the company. So the core strategy of the Baker Hughes merger made sense. We're going through right now a lot of value creation and transfer of technology, transfer of best practices, cost synergies. So we want to let that play out so that the maximum value is created at Baker Hughes from this combination. And then it's going to be ready to be a strong standalone company, and we'll have our options to put it in that position. And we'll share those with you as we go.
You know, John, it's funny, in just texts and emails from investors and the like, I think the one area that people still don't have a great deal of confidence is the balance sheet.
Yeah.
They're still concerned that either you've missed something, or why the $3 billion to GE Capital? Why not more or why less? How do you go about winning back the confidence of those who are just, who look at the balance sheet, not necessarily how you run the businesses, but the balance sheet, and go,
those are two central things. I focus a ton of my time on the operations of the company. And that's ultimately, you know, our mission is to make the operations of the company better, more cash, better return, better capital allocation, less costs, less bureaucracy, all that stuff. That's key. I spend an equal amount of time looking at the balance sheet. I grew up in financial services. I have a total respect for what it means to have a strong balance sheet or what it means to be encumbered by a weak one. So I think when people have time to process what we talked about today, they're going to see a dramatic change in the leverage capability of the company, a reduction in our leverage down to a much, much lower level.
So that less than 2.5 times by 2020, you feel confident you can achieve that?
Oh, absolutely.
That's on the table.
No,
you see a clear road.
Absolutely. Jamie laid out today the exact path there. What we're transferring to healthcare, cash, there's no doubt about that. And then I think what's important today for the people thinking about the balance sheet, and we've been thinking about it, is that we laid out a package of about $60 billion of potential value sources. 25 of that goes to the deleveraging of the company. That leaves an immense amount of surplus, if you will, to deal with leverage and risk going forward. So I looked carefully at the balance sheet. It's clear we know how to get to the end point and how we're going to do it, and we have surplus. So, you know, I think when we spend some time with people, they'll see that.
John, I've said this on air a couple of times. I spent a lot of time at 30 Rock, of course. Used to be the home of NBC. Is the home of NBC. Used to be a GE company. And there are many employees there who still own stock.
Yeah.
It's been painful.
Yeah.
And these are not people who are necessarily that highly compensated.
Yeah.
What do you tell to people like that at this point?
So first, I share in every sense the pain, if you will. My life savings is in the stock. So I have the same sort of connection to the issue. The second thing I'd say is we've gone through a tough patch. We've faced into the issues. We're dealing with the issues. We have a plan. We know where we are. We're realistic about that. We know exactly where we want to go with the portfolio, with the balance sheet, with how we run the company. And we know exactly how to get there. And stay tuned for the ride here. Our task right now is execution, but it's clear where we want to go. It's clear how we're going to do it. And I am really confident that there's a real opportunity for value creation from where we are today. I understand the journey to where we are today, but I've got to look forward, and I'm really optimistic about that. And I am invested in that in every sense of that word. So I would say hang in there.
All right. You know, good place to end.
Okay.
John, thank
Great.
You very much for joining us
No,
today.
Thank
really
you, Sarah, Carl, thanks. David, thank you.
John Flannery, of course, CEO of GE.